we're gonna go next year, but we're gonna redo our kitchen.
I'm sorry to see that no one sat in front of the room because there was a secret under one of the chairs in the first two rows. There was a ridiculous free property tax next door. None of you are qualified. First, I'd like to offer an opportunity for all the boards and committees here that have a quorum to call themselves to order. I know the selectmen are in your post.
I'll call board of selectmen order.
Is there anyone else? Okay, thanks. Just for some logistics, after tonight's meeting, the next public meeting that will be similar, MAPC will mention, but it's September 23rd, with an objective to make a final presentation to the board of selectmen sometime in November, just so you can get that out of the calendar. I want to welcome everyone and thank you for coming. A special thanks for Jean and Jesse in our planning area and for MAPC, who will introduce themselves shortly, for all the work that's being done in this. It's been a long process. It includes zoning revisions and lots of other meetings. And I thought I'd just tell those of you something, a story that came that's interesting. Last week, we were very fortunate to have one of the secretaries, Secretary Jay Ash, of Housing and Economic Development come visit the town. And he was most impressed with all the work that's going on here. I dared him to criticize us, one in criticism, he's still thinking about it. But one of the things he really commended the town was outreach to the community. Most communities don't do that. And you guys are the reason we got that compliment. So thank you for coming to all these meetings. Not only are we having meetings that maybe 5 or 10 people would come, but it's a room for it. It's great. So without any further ado, I'd like to start us off by introducing Jen from MAPC. Jen.
Hi, I see a lot of familiar faces, so good to see some of you that we saw at the April 1st meeting. So this, as Bob mentioned, this is the second of three public meetings related to this project. And we actually started this process back in, I believe it was July of last year. So a lot of work has happened and there's a lot more to be done. So thank you for taking the time of your evening to join us. So, I wanted to give you an overview of the evening. So we're actually going to spend a lot of the time breaking out into discussion stations. And you'll have a chance actually over 90 minutes to visit up to 5 different discussion stations around the room to talk one-on-one with our project staff and learn more about the different elements of this project. I will give some more background for those of you who weren't at the first public meeting to understand what this project is and what the deliverable is to the town. So I will get to that. But you know, we'll give a 20-minute overview of the project work that's happened to date. Then we'll go into 90 minutes of discussion stations. Hello?
Hello?
Okay. So just to repeat, so we'll give about 15 minutes of project overview for those of you who missed the first public meeting. Then we will.
Jen, sorry, can you just make it a little bit louder?
Oh, you know, it turned off. I think the battery. I think I need to keep it held down. I'll keep it. Yeah, it's flickering. So
there we go.
Okay.
There.
I will keep my finger on it. So there will be 90 minutes for you to visit 5 discussion stations around the room, and that's a chance for you to talk with our project staff and learn more about the different elements of this project. And then we'll have report outs and then next steps and next meeting. But first, we'll spend about 15 minutes recapping what this project is for those of you who missed the first public meeting. So MAPC, we're the regional planning agency for Metro Boston. We serve 101 cities and towns. Reading is in the north suburban sub-region of MAPC, which serves 9 communities. Amanda Chisholm, my colleague, is here. She is your sub-regional coordinator. So if you have any needs and any needs or questions about what our agency does, please come to her after the meeting and sign up for our North Suburban mailing list. I also want to take a moment to acknowledge a couple of my other MAPC colleagues that are here today. Chris Kuchel is a regional planner, and he works in our transportation division. Karina Milchman, she is also a regional planner, and her work includes work on housing. Eliza Wallace, she's from our data services division. She does mapping and data analysis for us. Carlos Martinez is our senior regional planner, and he's in our land use division. We also have Emma, who's a new intern with us from the Harvard Graduate School of Design. So thank you, everyone, and they're here tonight so you can learn more about our work and the different elements of this project. So Metro Future, we are a regional planning agency. We have what's called the Metro Future Vision. It's a vision that articulates a number of goals and strategies for creating a greater Boston region between now and 2035. It's a very long document, but if I were to distill it in a couple of key ways, it's about how do we grow in the region in a way that's fair for everyone that lives here? How do we increase access to opportunities, housing, jobs, quality of life, recreation, so that people have access to the right to live in communities where they have access to all of those amenities? Metro Future thinks about and cares about equity and inclusion and diversity. Our interest in working with the town of Reading has tremendous assets, including the commuter rail station, the diversity of businesses, strong schools. So working with a community like Reading, you are a smart growth location. And so this strategic economic development action plan is about looking at those areas that are ripe for growth and helping to figure out, what are those strategies in the next 5 to 7 years that the town can prioritize that can build on and advance and support economic development in those areas. So just a map of our sub-region again, and those are the communities that Reading and the other communities that are in North Suburban. So tonight's goals, these are the discussion stations where you'll learn more about the elements of this project. So you'll learn about the market for retail, office, mixed use, and residential development in Reading. Our staff did a retail, office, and residential market analysis, so there'll be one station where you can learn more about that. You'll also learn about the redevelopment potential of 4 priority development areas in town. I'll talk more about what those areas are and how we came to identify those, but there will be a station where you can learn more about the potential of those areas. You'll also learn about how we use the visual preferences that you all shared at the April 1st public meeting, where you voted up on images and shared comments on design, density, and uses, and how we're using that information to inform urban design work we're doing to show what might be possible for redevelopment. And you'll also have the opportunity to provide feedback on draft design concepts that we've actually done for a couple of areas in town. And also, through visiting the different stations, you'll be able to suggest actions that we can consider as we put together the draft action plan, which you will see in a more hard copy form at the September 23rd public meeting. So project goals and overview. What are we delivering? So our goal is by early November, we will deliver a strategic economic development action plan for the town that identifies strategies it can take over the next 5 to 7 years to implement their economic development vision. And the focus is on 4 priority development areas the town has identified, and these are the 4 areas. And when you came in, you picked up a handout that had information on current development in each of these areas. These are the proposed expansion of the 40R district, which is on the map as PDA 1A and 1B, PDA 2, which is South Bay Street, PDA 3, New Crossing Road Redevelopment District, and PDA 4, 1 General Way. And I will note that when the town last did a master plan, the economic development section also highlighted several of these areas as also priority for development back in 2005. So how did we identify these 4 areas? About 3 years ago, the North Suburban Planning Council, sub-region that I mentioned, underwent this process involving 8 of the communities to identify local and regional priorities for development and preservation. The town, we had back and forth with the town, we presented to the Board of Selectmen and to the Planning Commission, and there's a process to identify, of these areas that are priority development areas, what types of development might be suitable in each of these areas. The town selected a number that they thought were suitable, and that was informed by a lot of the conversations that have already been happening in the community. What was MAPC's job? Our job was to use all the data that we have available to us to help identify and analyze the suitability for all of these priority development areas to accommodate different types of development. So this is an overview of some of those considerations. So just to give you an example, if an area is identified as potentially being suitable for housing, for example, is it close to the commuter rail or bus or other areas? If an area is identified suitable for commercial, are there any wetlands constraints? So we use available data so that we can have conversation with the town to say, the development types you've selected, based on what we know about the area and your existing assets and constraints, what could be suitable for development? So I believe the town had probably a list of local priorities that was 2 or 3 times the number that we ended up selecting, but these 4 areas that we're talking about tonight are those that were identified as regionally significant priority development areas in Reading. So this is the map that you can see it probably much more clearly in the handout that you have. So with that, I'll turn it over to Amanda. Okay, I think this is on. You guys can hear me okay?
Yeah.
All right. So I'm Amanda Chisholm. I'm a regional planner at MAPC. We did talk a little bit about this market analysis at the last meeting, so I'm going to go through this fairly quickly, but don't worry, we have a whole station on it, so if you have a lot of questions, I'm happy to field all of those, and we can talk about it in more detail during the station area. We just wanted to take the time during the presentation to give a little bit of the overview so that you have this in mind in terms of the context for opportunities as you're going through the stations later on. So the first thing that we do with any market analysis is we want to talk to the people on the ground. We want to talk to the people who every day are experiencing the market, who understand the challenges, see the opportunities, and really have that local sense of, you know, where can we go? So we go out, we talk to retailers, we talk to business owners, property owners, we want to talk to developers, brokers, and really get a sense from them in terms of the challenges and opportunities. So these are a couple of the highlights that we heard. In terms of retailers, we heard a lot about Reading being a really great community, a great local loyal customer base. We heard good demographics, good spending power. That's something that developers, especially commercial developers, would be looking for if they want to locate in a community. While most of the retail businesses said they were doing fairly well, there's still some exceptions and some things that aren't going as well. And a lot of retailers are actually working together to try to improve that situation and bring them together and really get more people downtown and shopping locally. There's minimal turnover though, that's good news, pretty low vacancy, and also competitive rents. So those are all things that are pretty positive from the retail perspective. In terms of residential, we wanted to know what business owners thought. Would that be something that would be beneficial to bring more residential to these priority development areas? You know, we heard mixed reviews, but a lot of business owners did feel like it would be advantageous because it would bring more people onto the streets, more activity, and more business for their particular store. In terms of the single family, we talked to brokers who mentioned that obviously that's the market that's doing really well here. You guys probably see this every day. A lot of people want to move here. You know, you have a great school system. A lot of families are attracted to the community. But there's also a significant demand for multifamily, especially alternatives as seniors are looking to downsize. They want to stay in the community, maybe sell out their single family home, do a little bit less maintenance, but be able to stay around and be able to afford that. We heard in terms of offices that there may be potential for some small professional offices to add to what's already downtown, and also some potential for some limited new office development in some of these priority development areas. So in terms of retail, we do a gap analysis. Very basically, that's looking at the residential spending power within a certain area and comparing that to the supply or how many retail stores are present in that particular industry. And then it really reveals, are there opportunities to introduce additional retail within that area? So we did this for the study area and found that the local market could likely support around 6 stores. And the regional market, which is, I should mention, a 15-minute drive time, the local market is a 10-minute drive time around the priority development areas. The regional market increases to 18. So that means if you can get more people coming here from 15 minutes away, you can support more establishments. A lot of these are going to be restaurants, which is a nice alignment because restaurants do tend to have more of a regional draw and they do better with clusters. But again, you know, you're really going to have to be strategic if you're going to be able to attract that many people, you know, keeping in mind competition in other communities as well. Opportunities are also food stores, health stores, and used merchandise. If the town wants to take advantage of this, and this is something that people are really interested in, introducing more retail, strategies to think through, first of all, filling in those downtown vacancies, concentrating the new retail and restaurants in the downtown area or around the downtown area so that it's all contributing to one another rather than taking away, and then making downtown a destination. So how can you get more people downtown other than just restaurants and stores? Maybe you can do events, maybe you can have public art, other things going on that really make the downtown a destination. We looked at the office market as well. In general, the greater Boston market is doing very well. There's a lot of office development happening. You probably see it every day as you're driving around, taking the train. Some speculative development as well, so not necessarily tenants secured already. So the market's doing very good. When you drill down to the sub-regional level, so Reading is in the Boston North sub-region, you do see that there's some improvement. That's
kind of keeping pace with the greater Boston, but it's not doing quite as well as some of the other suburban markets. So 128 Mass Pike is a really good example of a suburban market that's really taking off. The rents are really high, the year-over-year growth is great, the vacancies are filling. The north sub-region where Reading is doing well in those indicators, but not quite as well as a suburban market like 128. So the good news is improving, the bad news is that not quite as well as some other suburban markets. There are opportunities, definitely, as I mentioned, small professional offices downtown and maybe in the South Main Street area. There is a large office tenant that would be supported by the regional market overall, but there's a lot of competition. So you're going to be competing with a Woburn, with a Burlington, a Cambridge that's really also trying to draw in these offices. And they have a lot of commercial already, which is something that's very attractive to office space. So again, doesn't mean it can't happen, but it just means you need to really think through strategies for how to do that. And lastly, build-to-suit would be your greatest potential because you've already secured a tenant, you're building for that tenant, and that helps to secure project financing as well. So that's just a good strategy in terms of trying to bring in a larger commercial tenant. Again, if the town wants to pursue these strategies. And then lastly, for the residential market, we also took a look at the housing market. So we citizens in Reading, you can probably see every day, you know, the values are going up. The market here for housing is very strong. Prices are really at all-time highs, condos are increasingly popular and expensive. There's definitely a high opportunity here, and especially in areas that are close to amenities like the downtown, like the priority development areas. In terms of town-wise, so this is not just the priority development areas, it's the entire town. Our MAPC projections show over 950 potential units over the next 5 to 10 years. Again, that's a projection. Doesn't mean it's going to happen, but that is what the projections show could be potentially supported here. There's strong demand, as I mentioned, for housing in or near downtown. And as I mentioned before, seniors are really looking to downsize. They want to locate in these areas. And it aligns really well with younger households that also want to be in areas where there are amenities, where life's a little easier. You can go out the door, grab what you want, maybe go to a local restaurant and jump on the commuter rail. So there's a nice alignment in terms of those two groups at this point in time that might help support some more multifamily housing. So that's just a very brief overview. As I mentioned, we'll talk about it more here, but just to set the context for this experience.
So I wanted to recap one of the things we did at the April 1st meeting. So we engaged folks in a visual preference polling exercise where we showed images of different types of developments from the MAPC region. And we asked people to give us some comments about what they liked or didn't like about different images. They were examples of housing, commercial, mixed use, different types of images. And we needed that information so that it could inform our urban design work, so that we made sure any renderings we did of redevelopment potential were exemplary of the kinds of things that appealed to folks. And we also needed that information so that we could have it inform our scenarios modeling, which is a database tool that allows us to analyze the development potential in the priority development areas. And when we had some of that information from you about what types of uses people were open to, that informed how we did that modeling. So you'll see the results of that feedback tonight. So I did want to recap for you what we heard from all of you that were at the last meeting. So these are 5 images of different developments from our region that were voted up the most in the process. So the image in the top left is a development called Castle Courtyard in Natick, and people thought this was appealing and potentially suitable for, as an example of the kind of development that could happen in PDA number 1. Some of the things people said, good landscaping, very proportional, nice, good building offset, nice arches, appropriate window to wall ratio. The image in the middle is of a mixed-use development. And people said they liked, the well-articulated roofline, the bays and contours, they liked the parking and bath, and they liked the benches, seating, the open space, the public realm and elements of this type of development. And this is an example of mixed use.
That PDA 3, people, sorry, this one, the middle one, it was an example that people said it could be suitable in South Main Street, PDA 2. PDA 3, people said that the development that's in the top right, which is an example of mixed use, was one that they thought could be suitable. And they said the inclusion of the retail on the first floor was nice, and that mix of uses could also be especially good for seniors in town.
for it to create easy access to the marketplace. And some people also felt it could be suitable in 1B. And then the examples on the lower left and lower right are examples of commercial. You know, people called out that they liked you know, the brick, they liked the public realm improvements, the landscaping, the trees. They felt like height-wise, you know, this one was a little high, that, you know, 3 to 4 stories is sort of more what people are really comfortable with, but that they felt like they could see this kind of development in PDAs 3 and 4. So here are just some more summaries of the kinds of comments that we heard when we were going through all of the images. So, you know, we looked at everything people said, even for those images that really didn't get voted up, but things that people said they really liked and things that they really didn't like. So it's just a summary of some of those. So again, height and size being very important. You know, 3 to 4 stories is the preferred. You know, anything higher than that, it's difficult to see in town. In terms of, you know, the facade, people like distinguished water floors, variation in the design. Brick details, any images that we, you know, show that had brick details were very appealing. Roofs, people definitely said that, you know, pitched roof structures are preferred. And in terms of style, aesthetic, you know, signage is very, very important. You know, people like the idea of contemporary but not sterile. And they also like the blending of traditional and modern elements. And we also showed some images of public realm improvements. So, you know, having more wider sidewalks, brick crosswalks, you know, in areas where there's restaurant uses, you know, outdoor seating and windows that open to the street, and this idea of having more social activities and social areas to activate the public spaces. And then this is a recap of the types of uses that people said that they thought were appropriate and appealing in the different PDAs. So mixed use in PDA 1 and in PDA 1. In PDA 2, the idea of including more retail and having more mixed use, having commercial on first floor, housing above was appealing. In PDA 3, people liked some of the examples that showed mix of uses, but people also really emphasized wanting to attract more commercial to that area. And in general, it was also very challenging to picture residential, inclusion of residential in PDA 3, as it currently is. So that was a quick 15-20 minutes overview of what we discussed at the last public meeting and the work we've done thus far, the market analysis and the visual preference. So now I'm going to shift us to the next piece, which is 90 minutes. So this approach is called World Cafe. Basically, it's a course that allows you to visit different discussion stations over 90 minutes. So what I'll ask is that for those of you where you're sitting, you'll see that there are 5 stations that are around the room. There are actually 2 for urban design because we didn't want to be too crowded. Both stations will provide the same content. There's 1 station in urban design here. There's 1 in that back corner. We also have a station on market potential, and that's here against the windows. We also have a station on connectivity, and that table is in back that's going to be pulled into the middle of the room. And then we also have a station on development potential, which is in the all the way in the back. So you have a choice to start anywhere. So every 20 minutes, I'm going to make an announcement on this to say it's time to transition, and you can choose to go to any other station. I would say that because we have so many people in the room, if you see about, you know, 10 to 15 chairs already in a station, try to find another station just so we can comfortably be at each spot. And no worries, because we're going to have 3 transitions. You'll have a chance to hit every single station over the next 90 minutes. So with that, I will say for the facilitators at each station, if you just want to sort of stick your hand up so people know where to go, make your way to your first station and feel free to just turn the transmitter if you want to go first.
I'm going to take it down right now. To orient the debate, let's create a problem. I am the Thank you. Yeah. I'm And it's so affordable. I can buy one now. My son can get an hour, and it's like, terrible. So yeah, I wish she's 3 hours ago. Well, it's this time of year.
Yeah.
You know, and I think it is healthier. It's good for your brain. It's more healthier for your brain now, but it tastes better than McDonald's.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
And if I'm out from 5 to 8, we'll see.
I saw her name's new post and she was in the paper today for appointment.
Oh, yeah. Isn't that nice?
Yeah, I was like, congratulations, you came with the chamber first. She's got appointed as like a child special. I don't know.
I don't know the actual name.
Yeah. Beautiful.
Yeah.
I I'm going to Thank you. All right, Joey. All right, very nice meeting. Yeah, great. Roberta, Bobby. They call her Bobby. Everybody loves that.
Oh my God, it's such a
You know, they just got rid of that.
Oh my God.
Well, then they could make it a little bit
rare.
More pointed that way, but it's kind of chaos of noise. Yeah. You really can't pick out, other than occasionally pick out a voice here or there. I thought I heard Gene Delio, sir.
All right, well, I'm going to take off. All right, next meeting is
yours. Yeah, it's probably not exciting to come to. It's not like an organized meeting. I'll make some comparisons.
Good.
Hard up the process. You can also just say, we don't have the sewer infrastructure. We say, yay, out here, and then say, we can come and have a truck access around the corner. Yeah. You know, and so that goes back to Cone's office. Fire marshal says, yeah, you know, they face that truck with the cross. No problem.
Yeah. intriguing.
So, but the biggest, yeah, the biggest
thing. Oh, you know, we're blocking this.
Is
when you want to be here. Certainly during commute hours, I don't know about other times, but commute hours always. because it's, and I think it's there as a deterrent. I don't know if they made the car. Actually, we can ask Mark. No, the answer is there. Yeah, he would know the answer. But it strikes me as, you know, I always look there and say, crossing is, there's so much traffic. And, you know, people want to run to catch the train. It's crazy. So that could be a bridge. And then the three, so the represents that owner. Yeah, so I don't know who he is, but we're going to find out. She has all sorts of points. So it'd be great to kind of go with what they're doing.
I'm going to go to the next one. Overall, I thank everybody very much sort of liked the concept. The one dissenter was Mr. Jack Russell back there. He had a very different conception of what the space should be. He thought very much giant sort of office buildings. But in general, people liked it. They thought the general kind of concept of the open space was sort of two types of open space, sort of a plaza area, and then more of a grassy natural area made a lot of sense. Having that space for sort of bed space, kind of reserving something, could be an ice skating rink in the winter, for example. People like that idea. People were very interested in having the parking lot not just be a piece of concrete or asphalt, but having it contain permeable surfaces, contain street trees, making it pleasant. There was a lot of input in terms of the pedestrian network. We really want people to be able to walk around safely, including from the parking areas, which, again, people tended to agree that keeping the parking in back made a lot of sense. In general, people like the scale, sort of three stories or so, two or three stories. In general, people like the mix of uses, kind of having housing or residential along Ash Street, but staying away from residential in the back of the site. I think that pretty much covers the gist of what I heard. I'll pass it over to the other urban design station.
Thanks. Oh.
Oh,
you guys can hear me?
Yeah.
So I will not repeat everything that Chris said happened or was said at his urban design station, but at the one up front, people also, there seemed to be consensus that they liked the general design concept, the scale, the attention paid to having open space and other other areas or land uses that would serve the broader community and bring people into the site, as well as benefit the people who might be living there and working there. Most of our conversation focused actually on what surrounds the site and traffic issues and circulation issues, which is really interesting to hear that that did not come up at the other urban design station, so it's good we had two. But there was a lot of discussion around the intersection that's sort of up here and ideas about maybe a light or some other traffic mitigation issues so that that was not so clogged and access down Ash Street wouldn't be such an issue. There was some concern about just having access to the site be limited to Ash Street. Some thoughts about maybe having an access right away over here down at the bottom of the site. Some brainstorming ideas about having an air, like a footbridge, to connect PDA 3 with PDA 4. But people were very interested in having the site be more accessible from a number of different points and not having additional traffic generated along Ash Street. Related, there was a lot of interest in having the site be multimodal and the circulation around the site, not only within it, also be multimodal, so safe and comfortable for pedestrians as well as cyclists, and also navigable for autos. And that was pretty much the gist. Amanda?
Okay, so at the market analysis station, we talked about the market potential. We heard from most people that commercial would be a good idea for the town. It would help to help a little bit with the tax base, and it would also be great to just have more options here, especially in terms of retail. A mix of uses seemed like people were generally supportive of. We did talk about residential and the fact that having more residential could potentially bring more families and school children, which is a concern in terms of an overburdened school system, but we also talked about how multifamily is really the demand here and how this might not actually bring in as many school children, and also gives seniors that opportunity to sort of downsize in their own community in a way that's more affordable. We talked about that 950 unit number seeming a little bit high. Again, I just want to reiterate for everyone, you know, that's townwide and it's the market overall, and it's really up to the town to sort of strategize around how they can pursue that housing development and that commercial development. And lastly, we also talked about some transportation connections, so how important it is to sort of capitalize on the commuter rail station. We talked about potentially putting in maybe like a flag stop or something closer to PDA 3 and 4, although acknowledging the challenges of potentially working with the MBTA on something like that. All these PDAs are walkable to the commuter rail, so just capitalizing on that connection and making that connection play. And I should also mention, we talked a little bit about strategy. So how does Reading actually move forward and attract that commercial development? How can Reading market themselves? So we really think that that's really moving forward. The market, the marketing of the town itself is really important. And how do you compete with these other big, you know, heavy hitters in terms of attracting office development in particular? So I can pass that to
I have to refer to maps. We had a lot of comments on a lot of similarity in our groups. I was at the connectivity table, and some of the recurring themes that we did have were along South Main Street. There was a lot of consensus about pursuing a road diet in order to slow down traffic, whether or not you could actually change the speed limit because it's a state road, but at least reducing the lane width for the travel lanes. And installing the center lane, that was an idea that all the groups seemed to believe in. There was also, similar to the urban design group, connectivity between PDA number 4 and PDA number 3, either a footbridge, either vehicular or not, having that some type of a connection there, regardless of the uses that were considered. There was also talk about there's two rail crossings over Main Street, and there was talk about eliminating one of those rail crossings that's apparently being used by one of the industrial uses in PDA number 3. If you could change the uses there and the developers there, you would reduce the reliance for that unnecessary second rail crossing. And what else? There was a lot of talk about the disconnect between the two supermarkets and about punching a hole basically along New Crossing Road. There's only about 25 feet that separate it, and that would actually provide an additional outlet. And there was a lot of consensus about making a left turn possible at General Way, instead of making everyone go around or through the parking lot back to that difficult intersection. So I think that's the main thing in our groups.
Well, I think I pass it to you. So Jesse was kind enough to take notes, so I'm actually going to pass it over.
All right, so I think everybody was pretty much comfortable with the idea of additional development potential in Reading. You know, a lot of people really enjoyed the idea of, you know, infill development, you know, less single family homes. They were more comfortable with the idea of doing multifamily in sort of the areas that are already developed, you know, the downtown area and parts of South Main Street. A lot of people have said that, you know, the town's improved a lot in the last 30 years. It's definitely more active downtown, but they would love to see more unique businesses come to downtown. So I think tying into that market analysis is going to be key. We had a couple comments about, you know, the zoning. I think everybody is pretty comfortable with, you know, the idea of making zoning changes to accommodate the potential, expanding the 40R, looking at other flexible ways under our current zoning to really meet that potential. We had a couple questions, you know, related back to how are we going to market Reading, how are we going to incentivize the developers to come to Reading as opposed to the Woburn, as opposed to Burlington. You know, really sort of focusing on how we're going to brand Reading and market Reading. I've got a second page. There was some concerns about, you know, additional commercial in the downtown. How are we going to address the traffic impacts? How are we going to look at parking? So I think all of that, you know, is you know, part of this plan, and we'll need to take that into consideration. And then there was one comment about, you know, when we look at the zoning and we're looking at maybe increasing the density of zoning, looking at possible buffer zones between our existing single family districts and potential commercial districts, and how do we sort of create that appropriate transition zones. So I think in general, everybody's pretty comfortable with, you know, development potential in all of the PDAs, you know, especially in the downtown. There was, you know, a few comments of let's do the 40R now. In the downtown, let's expand that now, not later. So I think that's, you know, everybody's in support of that. Miss anything?
I think that's pretty much covers it. Thank you, Mike.
I just want to thank all of our facilitators who have been talking and standing for about 90 minutes. I just want to appreciate that.
everyone for staying the evening. So I want to talk about where we go from here. So based on your feedback and also the town's interest in adding additional public process for this project, our next public meeting is on September 23rd from 6 to 9. We will explore getting a larger space so we're a little more comfortable if we do breakout discussion. I'm seeing a lot of nodding heads. So basically, between now and September, there are several important things we'll be doing. We'll be refining the urban design work with your feedback. We may make adjustments to the scenarios modeling, the estimates that we generated based on your feedback. We will, in earnest, start drafting the action plan strategies and conversation with the town and using the feedback we've received tonight and also from the April 1st public meeting. And at some point, either before or after that September 23rd meeting, we will release a draft for public comment that will go out for probably about 3 weeks. So I have all of you, if you signed in, please make sure you did sign in. That's a list I will be using to make sure we send you a direct link to the draft when it's up for public comment, and also a reminder of our September 23rd meeting. So we are actually at 8:30, so we are a bit early. Do folks have any burning questions or comments? Or suggestions? Yes.
Is this on RCTV's YouTube station? Will it be?
Yes, it will
yes.
be.
As of when?
Don't know.
Thank
Only
you.
A couple of days.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
The urban design really focused on one of the PDAs. Are you doing something similar without our input for the other three?
Unfortunately, in our budget, we only budgeted to do deep design work for one site, as an example. So the site planning, the massing, then the digitizing of these renderings is, it's a lot of work. So we're focusing on PDA 3. We did have a student intern who actually did some work on one parcel PDA 2, so you may have seen that set of renderings in that back corner in green. It was one of the sites that is on South Main Street. So that's sort of where we are now.
On your September 23rd, are you going to have more of those available for the other PDAs? More of those in depth?
Oh, it's a similar question that she asked.
Yes, so but I know for this one, but I'm saying for 23rd, the next meeting, will there be more just to be?
Yeah, it's really, so in our budget, we allocated funds to go, you know, deeply into examining the potential one site. So in conversation with the town, we picked site 3.
But there will, on September 23rd, be additional visuals for you to comment on, and they will be computer-generated and a lot more detailed. So we'll have sort of a refined site, illustrated site plan for you to comment on, as well as renderings and massings and all that good stuff. So there will be visuals for you to see that you haven't seen tonight. So I encourage you to come check them out.
But only on PDA 3.
But only on PDA
3. About having it in a larger space, so the hearings are better, like in high school.
We heard you loud and clear, so we're looking at a couple of other options for a larger space for the next meeting.
How do you plan to promote the next meeting? Because a lot of people about this one.
So I know the town did a mailing for this meeting. There was an actual letter mailed to everyone who lives within the area. We also do it through press release. I mailed everyone who came to the previous meeting. We also have a North Suburban Planning Council mailing list, which is Amanda's network, which goes to people also outside of Reading.
And we also, yes. We have a database in the Public Services Department with about 5,000 email addresses. So we sent out an email blast, I think a couple times, to all those email addresses that we have. So if you're not on that database, please feel free to let us know, and we'll get you on there so you know about these meetings.
Is that the
bi-weekly yes. update? Yes.
Maureen
Knight works in my office. Yep.
Is anyone not on that list? Just curious. Not on the bi-weekly. Okay. Great. We'll make sure we send. Of course, we always send our sign-in sheets to the town, so we'll make sure that they have it and can have you. Any other questions?
I have a comment more than a question. I represent one General Way, the 128 Marketplace, and I just want to, we didn't have much discussion about the PDA 4. I know the notes in the handout were that it was, you know, preference to residential or office use, and it is where the Market Basket is, and it is a retail center. So I just would like to get, you know, people's opinion and keep it on the radar that it is a retail center, and I hope that's, you know, where it continues to grow, and I hope that the town works to be a little bit more business friendly to people looking to come to Reading, because they are going to Woburn and Stoneham and Burlington, where it's a little easier and I hope we can, you know, get some quality tenants here for the town.
I will say that we have another team from our agency that's actually working with the town on a streamlined permitting guide to make sure that we're examining ways to clarify and streamline how people have access and approach the town.
If this is the one that you're digging deepest into, then I'm very concerned that there's not enough coordination with the RMLD, because that's a key piece of the town of Reading. And I am unconvinced that there's been enough work with them and that they're aware of what you know, people are planning. And before coming back to or releasing that draft plan, I think there should be some more evidence that there's been some work and really have reached out to them and are including them in this process. I'm a little uncomfortable with how
I don't know if you noticed earlier Colleen was here, O'Brien from RMLD.
Right, she was here for
they sure. are highly aware of what's going on. They had their own plan a year ago to study their own space. They had a resignation, they couldn't replace the person. So they're 6 to 12 months behind where they thought they'd be. And we had coordinated all this with in mind that they were studying their space needs. But she talked to me briefly tonight. She's talked to a lot of the property owners in her area. She's had conversations with the town. We're very familiar with what she would like to do, but she just hadn't had a formal study done yet. So we timed it a year ago as best we could. It hasn't dovetailed, but our RMLD is absolutely part of this discussion. Don't worry about that.
And two of their staff came to the last public meeting.
There we get tonight too.
We'll make a note of it to circle back if they have additional comments.
I spoke to Colleen for a good 15 minutes today and got a lot of actually really helpful input in terms of our work.
How about other business owners in the PDA 3 area? Many of them weren't aware of what was going on there.
I think that's one of the reasons we worked with the town to make sure there was a direct mailing and a flyer that went out to everyone.
Oh, no, we got that. We just, you know, didn't know about the big, what was going on. Just like RMLD didn't seem like, not to, you know, just kind of go back.
Well,
and
that's
but,
the
know.
Mailing was in order for you to come to see.
Right. Okay. So this is the first one.
Yeah. This is the first step.
Okay.
Yeah.
As I mentioned, so a big chunk of our time and work between now and September is refining the urban design work and digitizing it. So, you know, we can talk with the town and figure out if there's a way we can circle back with some of those owners, including those that were here tonight. Any other questions, comments? All right. Well, thank you very much for spending an evening with us.
Thank
and
you.
Please take some food with you if you'd like. And we hope to see you in September.
Thank you.